Now, how long is marriage to last? Any union that does not last until death falls short of God's purpose. God meant that marriage was to go on and on and on until death do you part, no matter what. Many magazine articles are being written on how to save the home. Penetrating analyses are being made as to the reasons for the breaking of the home. But the Bible has regulations concerning marriage. And if these regulations were followed carefully in every home, there'd be very little divorce. And unhappiness in the home would be greatly diminished. There's not going to be any perfect marriage. You're never going to be married to a perfect man or a perfect woman. There is no such person. I heard many years ago the story of a preacher that was preaching. And he was talking on this subject, and he said to the women present, or to the men present, how many of you have ever heard of a perfect marriage? And how many of you have ever heard of a perfect man? And he was surprised when a little dried up shrimp of a fellow stood up and said, I have. And so the preacher said, well, who? He said, my wife's first husband must have been perfect. The basic reasons for unhappiness in the American home are to be found in the fact that we've departed from God's Word. We've refused to acknowledge His plan for the family. But what does the Bible say? First, the duty of the husband. My wife thinks that I don't spend enough time on this subject when I preach on the home. But I know one thing, the husband is to love your wife. Ephesians 5:33 says, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself. The husband is to love the wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, according to Ephesians 5:25. God says in Colossians 3:19, husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. That word harsh means don't make cutting remarks. I never have admired a man who criticizes his wife and holds her up to ridicule. But when I was a boy, I used to hear it, not in my home, because my father and mother treated each other as they should have been treated and set an example for us. But we're to say it with small gifts and flowers. Did you know women would rather have little things like that than anything in the world? Just something thoughtful, maybe a postcard or birthday card or something like that. Not necessarily a box of candy. Most of them are trying to reduce. A man happened to remember his wife's birthday and he rushed to the shop and got candy and flowers. And he went home and he rang the doorbell and he began to sing, happy birthday, sweetheart. She came to the door and burst into tears. She said, oh, Jim, this has been a terrible day. The children have been so bad, and the roast is burned, and the phone is rung all day, and now you come home drunk. Now, if you give your wife a gift, and it's not a birthday, and it's not an anniversary, and it's not Christmas, or something like that, and you bring it home, she may be shocked into a heart attack. Be careful. Not only is the husband to love the wife, but secondly, the husband is primarily to provide for the wife. Now notice I said primarily. In some pagan countries I've been to, the woman does all the hard manual labor. But Christianity does not allow the woman to live in idleness, but it lays on the man the primary responsibility for providing the support of the family. But if any provide not for his own, the scripture says in 1 Timothy 5:8, and especially for those of his own house, he hath denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. I know that women have to work, but there are a lot of people that feel that, you know, that she should have a career even while the children are growing up. And some have to have, but some do not have to have, unless you have to give your time to your children. I hear so many on television, they ask them what they do. They say, oh, I'm just a housewife. I'm just a mother. Well, that's the greatest thing in the world. You ought to shout it out. I'm a housewife and I'm proud of it. Now the husband is to be faithful to his wife. This is one of the few sins for which God demanded the death penalty in the Old Testament. Did you know that? God demanded the death penalty in the Old Testament because of adultery. And then fourthly, the husband is to give the wife his confidence. She's not a plaything. She's not just an ornament. She is a helpmate in all features of your life. And you're to confide in her, get her advice and her counsel. And then fifthly, the husband is to lead in the religious instruction in the home. The Christian husbands and wives are the simplest form of the local church. The Lord said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in the midst. Where two are gathered, just you and your wife, I'm in the midst. And wonderful thing for the children to see the father leading the devotions. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he'll not depart. If anyone thinks he can train up a child in the way he ought to go and not walk that way himself, he'll be disillusioned. You must set the example in prayer, in Bible reading, in church going, in honesty, in integrity. They're going to learn far more by watching you than what you're teaching them. You young men, ask yourself this question. Can I be all? I mean, if you're courting now, and you're thinking about getting married, ask yourself this question about the girl you're going with. Can I be all this to the girl of my choice? Am I willing to give her myself and not substitute things for myself? When I learn what faults she has, am I willing to cover them in love with God's help? When the two of you get married and you start getting up together and using the same bathroom, and you see him and you smell his breath, and he sees you with your curlers and all the other things, will you still love each other? Ask yourself those questions, because the first part of marriage is tough. If you can get through about 3 to 5 years, you've got it made. But it's that first part. And many people think that, oh my, the honeymoon lasts on and on. With some people it does. But with most people, there's an adjustment period that's very, very difficult. And rather than to advertise my embarrassment by publicly criticizing her, am I willing to be patient, to cherish her as God would have me to do? If you're not, then don't marry her. And the same for you young women. Now, what is the wife's responsibility? Wives, Ephesians 5, submit yourselves to your own husbands as unto the Lord. Now, that's been a stumbling block to many people. The Greek word for submit is one which means to adapt yourself one to another in the Lord. And this adjustment can be a thrilling thing. We come from different backgrounds, different homes, different parents, different professors, different situations, different cultures, all kinds of differences. And yet we are to adjust until we actually become one. And I've met many couples who are celebrating their 30th or 40th or 50th wedding anniversary, and they've even grown to look like each other. I've seen that happen. People say that my wife and I look alike. I'm sorry for her. Dr. Young once said that seldom or perhaps never has a marriage developed into an individual relationship smoothly and without a crisis. Expect some differences. Don't be surprised when they come. Crisis will come. Troubles will come. Difficulties, difference of opinion will come. But your husband is not really first. God must be first in your marriage. Put him first. You know, my wife has written a lot of poetry. There's one book of poems out. She doesn't like her poems to be published, but here's one that she probably will not like for me to read. She wrote it to me before we were married. She said, "My soul will never, never be yours alone. But bid me live for him and know that I would die for thee. My lips will always seek your own, but my soul can never be yours alone. That is God's. Please don't touch it. I wouldn't touch the soul of that great woman for anything in the world, except I nourish her and enrich her and love her and try to teach what little bit I know, because she knows the Bible so much better than I do. Now, the wife is also to love the husband. Titus 2:4, to love your husband. And thirdly, the wife is to be primarily responsible for keeping the home. Notice, primarily. Now, you may work all day, and you have to come home at night and be a servant and fix dinner and provide his slippers and take care of him, be sexy later on. It's not easy. It's a lot tougher on the wife than it is the husband. There needs to be communication that God can help you with. Understanding, mutual help. The husband and wife are equal in mind and conscience and position and privilege and happiness. There's a balance of power. Any carelessness in your dress or personal appearance will detract from the admiration and love that your husband has for you. What about divorce? Sometimes divorce has to take place, and you may be the innocent party. Well, suppose afterwards you get converted and come to Christ. What are you supposed to do? Suppose you've been remarried. You cannot unscramble eggs. Stay as you are would be my advice. But you seek God's advice and God's counsel. What about your home? Does it belong to Christ?